Hey guys, Dr. Israel here for our fourth presentation, and an introduction to bioenergetics, real basic overview, probably taking about 10 to 15 minutes here, and really give you guys a very basic overview because we'll be diving into this in class in a really, really big way. Just the basics here, let's take a look. So, first thing, I want you to memorize exactly what this looks like because it'll be directly on the quiz. You'll have to draw it. Just kidding, that's a joke. So, fundamentally, really important, carbohydrates are composed of carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen, right? Their general formula here is H2O, and then an N, so the N multiplies across everything, so C6H12O2, that's glucose, or O6, that's glucose. And, of course, alterations in atomic arrangement makes molecules distinctly different. Carbohydrate is a very simple organic molecule, very related molecule is fat, very related molecule is protein, and all the other molecules in the human body start out from essentially some of these basic atoms in addition to a couple of others. So, two very, very important laws of energy for you guys. The law of conservation of energy, it's technically known as law of conservation of mass energy, states that energy is transferred between forms, but it can neither be created nor destroyed. So, when the sun is pooping out a ton of energy, that energy isn't destroyed, it just goes to other places, and we can use our solar panels and pick it up, and the solar panel doesn't steal energy, create any energy, it takes that energy from the sun, and it puts it possibly into a battery. Now we have that energy in a battery, we can put it in a little robot, the robot will walk around for us, and now that's mechanical energy. The energy changes forms, there's no way to create or destroy any new energy. Matter is technically made of really bunched up energy. So when a nuclear bomb destroys a bunch of matter to create tons of energy, no new energy is made, that energy has always been there in all of those molecules and atoms and that actual mass. Energy cannot be created or destroyed. Super, super important concept. Another important concept is the law of entropy or the law of directionality. It says that on average, processes tend to go from more order to less order, unless we put lots of energy into them. Here's a good example. If you just let your car sit in the garage for, let's say, 1,000 years, is it going to look cooler and have more components and a new exhaust pipe and be really clean after 1,000 years? No, it's going to get dilapidated and fall apart, more disordered. So how do you get a car to actually be built? What does General Motors do in their factory that's really magic? Well, their factory takes a lot of energy to run. If you put a lot of energy, a lot of work into a car, you can buy a new exhaust pipe, new windows, new tints, everything, and it becomes more complex, more ordered. So, unless we put a ton of energy into a process, that process tends to go to more disorder. And that's a fundamental reason for understanding bioenergetics and all the processes of the human body. Anytime something happens in the human body that takes a bunch of molecules and makes them into more ordered complex molecules, almost certainly that process took more energy, and that energy has to come from somewhere. For humans, it comes from the food we eat. All right. So, there are two types of essential processes in metabolism. Metabolism is the sum of all chemical reactions in the body, and it can be split up into two processes. Catabolism, okay, which is up there, is the process of breaking down large molecules, usually into smaller ones, and some energy. So when you eat food, food is broken down, and you get smaller molecules and energy. That's catabolism. On the other hand, anabolism is the process of taking smaller molecules and energy and using that energy to arrange those smaller molecules into bigger molecules. When you grow muscle from the food you eat, muscle proteins are really big and complicated. That's anabolism. So you're saying, oh, I want to get anabolic. That means you want to take the small molecules of amino acids that you have eaten and they're in your blood and then in your cells, take those amino acids, arrange them into bigger proteins and stick those proteins into your muscle fibers and essentially allow you to get bigger and stronger. So taking small molecules and using them to make bigger ones, with an energy of course, is called anabolism. Anabolism and catabolism are the two sides of metabolism, and metabolism is all the processes that happen in the human body. Metabolism can be measured, it turns out. And it's measured in the human body in calories, or kilocalories as they're otherwise known. Anytime you eat 500 calories from McDonald's, it's actually 500 kilocalories. A kilocalorie is technically the amount of heat, all right, heat energy it takes to raise 1 kilogram of water 1 degree Celsius if that water starts out at about 50 degrees Celsius. It's a very scientific way to measure how much energy expenditure the metabolism is actually incurring. All right, very, very simple concept. There's anabolism and catabolism. I guess I got ahead of myself. And metabolism is the sum of all of those actions. So, energy sources. Really, really important point. For most energy production, talking, walking, moving around, playing sports, the body uses almost exclusively carbohydrates and fats from the food you eat and from what you have stored in your body. Protein usually is used to make structures, but doesn't very often actually provide energy for anything you do. There's one exception. If you're starving, protein, primarily from your own muscles, is going to start to be used to produce energy. Unless you're starving, protein usually composes only 5% of your energy needs. Carbs and fats are our go-to molecules to actually give you energy for physical activity. Carbohydrates are usually very simple to digest. They're very simple to process, they're very simple to get energy from, and they're the number one go-to source for energy, especially for high-intensity athletic activity. Running marathons, playing soccer games, weightlifting is almost all fueled primarily by carbohydrate, right? And carbohydrate, it can be taken in from the blood once you eat it, but it's stored primarily in the liver and muscles in a very complex large molecule of glucose strung together called glycogen. And glycogen is a branched molecule, and it kind of looks like that if you look at the big picture. So in your muscles right now are a bunch of glycogen molecules or arrangements that it's a way to store glucose or carbohydrate for later activity. So if you want to come up and pick up a barbell and curl it a bunch, that carbohydrate is already there in your muscles and glycogen. It gets taken off, it gets sent into glycolysis or oxidative phosphorylation, and it provides that energy for those bicep curls right there and then. Fat, on the other hand, provides substantial energy during sort of prolonged low-intensity activity. If you are, let's say you're on a date and you're walking around a new city with a new friend and you walk for 4 hours seeing all these cool sights, walking is really low-intensity, and that is where fat comes in handy. You're using almost exclusively body fat or fat that you've eaten to fuel that sort of activity. When you're recovering from a high-intensity activity, let's say you played a soccer game and then you go home and rest afterwards, recovery, because it's also very low intensity, also uses a lot of fat. But if you're sprinting, running around doing really intense stuff, fat is very rarely used at that time. That's where carbohydrates come in. Now, the cool thing about fat is that carbohydrates provide a total in the average person stored in the body between your muscle glycogen or your liver glycogen of maybe about 2,500 calories. That's a lot of calories. That's a super, super intense a soccer game that lasts a really long time, something to that extent, a day's worth of activity. However, take a look. In the average person, fat provides almost 75,000 total stored calories. Fat has 9 calories per gram. Each gram of body fat has 9 calories of total energy, whereas proteins and carbohydrates only have 4 calories of total energy. So the body, now we know why we have body fat stores instead of just storing all our free calories as muscle. That'd be pretty cool. You eat a bunch of Ben & Jerry's ice cream and you get really huge. Unfortunately, it doesn't work like that. You get fat because fat is so efficient at storing calories. Every single gram of fat has 9 calories. That's why if you eat a bunch of food and your body goes, hey, we need to save this stuff up, you add body fat. Protein, mostly used to build structures. Occasionally, we'll use it for energy. Mostly what happens is we go through a process called gluconeogenesis, the creation of new glucose. You take a protein, protein's got everything the carbohydrate does except it also has a nitrogen group. So we take that nitrogen off, it essentially comes off as ammonia, we package that into urea, and you pee out the urea, and that's why pee smells funny. When we do that, we essentially take a protein and turn it into a carb, and we make new glucose out of that carbohydrate, and we use it for energy. It's not a process that happens very often. Sometimes it does, especially during starvation. All right. Aha. So, enzymes. Enzymes are an incredibly powerful tool in the human body. We won't look at this too much, just give you a quick chat about enzymes. The real power of enzymes is what they do is they lower the activation energy for chemical reactions. Normally, glucose actually does break down into pyruvate, which is a process called glycolysis. It's a process which we use in our bodies, we'll talk about it in just a second, to generate a lot of energy. If you take glucose, you take sugar, and you put it into a glass of water, and you put that glass of water on the counter, after a couple of thousand years, that glucose will actually turn into pyruvate and release energy. Heating that water up just a tad. Can we wait a couple thousand years during a soccer game to run over and score a goal? Of course not. So we have enzymes that take that glucose molecule, they don't add any energy to the equation, they just sit there, and because they provide a very awesome environment, these enzymes essentially clip onto glucose molecules and allow the glucose molecules to break down faster. How much faster? Thousands of times faster, so that instead of waiting a thousand years to get energy out of glucose, we can get it in milliseconds. And this happens all the time in the human body. So enzymes speed up the rate of reactions to the rate we need in our body by lowering the activation energy for those reactions. Instead of needing to burn glucose and have a ton of energy for it to actually release its heat, the enzymes lower the activation energy so that just your human body alone, the temperature it's working at, allows those reactions to go super, super fast as we need them. Enzymes are facilitators of reactions. The big thing you need to know is they allow the reactions we want to happen much, much easier. All right, so basically how an enzyme works, it sits there, a substrate, we'll call it a glucose molecule, enters the enzyme envelops that substrate, and inside that space, the activation energy is really low, and that reaction occurs really well and really, really fast. Normally, if we have that glucose molecule floating around, it floated around for 1,000 years before it ever broke into two. But inside this enzyme, it breaks into two immediately, the enzyme unclips, the two pyruvate molecules go somewhere else, and that's that. It happens really, really quickly. Now, enzymes work well in a very finite range of physical conditions. Three things particularly determine how fast an enzyme will allow the process to occur. Number one is pH. If you're at an optimal acidity, enzymes work really fast. Any more acidic or basic than that for each enzyme, they don't work anymore. For example, the muscles, the myosin ATPase that literally pulls your actin inside your muscle cells, has an optimal pH level just about the same as blood, somewhere in the sevens. So, if you produce enough lactate, if you're doing squat after squat after squat after squat, and your lactate levels start to go up, that turns a much more acidic environment. And all of a sudden, myosin ATPase does not work if the environment is too acidic. So instead of contracting, it just goes, and nothing happens. And that's how you reach muscular failure. So you squat, 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 and all of a sudden, you can't move anymore, and you fall, and the barbell falls on you, and you get rushed to the hospital. Hopefully, it doesn't happen that bad, but essentially, enzymes need to be in their own optimal pH. Good news is that there's different kinds of enzymes. In your actual stomach, there are enzymes that can work really, really well at a low pH. Why? Because the stomach is really acidic. Makes sense. Temperature. Body temperature is all optimal for almost all human enzymes. No surprise, because we're almost all at normal body temperature. What's interesting is that some enzymes really start to malfunction and break down and not do their job as temperature goes either really low or especially really high. And it turns out that bacterial enzymes, the enzymes that allow bacteria to function and make more of themselves, have a lower tolerance for heat than most human enzymes. So when you get sick, what happens? Your body runs a fever, jacks up that body temperature, and the bacterial enzymes stop working, and the bacteria goes, oh crap, and a bunch of it dies off. And hopefully, your fever doesn't get too crazy, and your own enzymes still work. Does that happen? You bet it does. People die from fever, or they used to all the time. They still do in third world countries. Nowadays, if you get fever too high, you get to the hospital, they bring it down for you. But temperature, for most enzymes, is optimal right around that middle range, whatever your normal body temperature is. And of course, a really big point number three for how enzymes function, how fast do they actually make a product, is the concentration of substrates in relation to the product. If you have an enzyme that allows glucose to get broken down for energy really fast, if you have just a tiny bit of glucose, you're just not going to get that much energy. If you have a ton of glucose, you're going to get really, really rapid reactions. The concentration of the actual substrates matters a whole lot. Alrighty, bioenergetics. I'm pretty much going to stay on this slide and just give you the real super basics about energy systems. There are three energy systems. They are delineated or used in the by the human body for three distinct functions. How rapid of an energy release do you want, and how much endurance or for how long do you need that energy? The first system is called the phosphagen system. It uses ATP that's available in the muscles. It also uses phosphocreatine, all right? Phosphocreatine works really simple. It's a creatine molecule that has a phosphate next to it. Keeps that phosphate with it, and whenever you have run low on ATP, it takes a phosphate and it donates it, and it makes more ATP. ATP produces tons and tons of energy, and the phosphagen system, because it has either just available ATP or phosphocreatine, and just one other system we're not going to talk about, the phosphagen system gives a ton of ATP really rapidly. So the phosphagen system is used for things like jumping, sprinting for probably 100 meters or less, tackling someone, lifting a really heavy weight one time, a ton of energy really quick. The problem is, the phosphagen system, as soon as it runs out of ATP, it takes a while to replenish, minutes, to get back up to the normal ATP levels. So the phosphagen system, the best analogy I have, is if you need water and you have a really big kiddie pool in your backyard and you take a knife and you cut that kiddie pool open and water spills right the heck out. You get a ton of water really quick, but what happens if you want to use that kiddie pool again to get water? Well, you have to seal up the crack and you have to pour water in and it takes a really long time. So the phosphagen system has produced a ton of energy really quickly, but it doesn't have very good endurance. Next system is better at kind of both of those things. The glycolytic system. It occurs in the cytoplasm just like the phosphagen system does. The glycolytic system is relatively straightforward. We start off with a glucose molecule, and through a complex series of reactions, we break it down into two pyruvate molecules. Sometimes they also turn into lactates. We'll talk about that in class. So you get glucose, two pyruvate molecules. During that time, a bunch of other stuff is made, but what's important to us for just glycolysis is that process makes ATP. We get energy out of taking that glucose and breaking it down into pyruvate. Awesome. Glycolysis doesn't produce as much energy per any unit time as the phosphagen system. Glycolysis is, instead of, let's say, the kiddie pool analogy, for glycolysis, we've got a fire truck with a fire hose. That's a ton of water coming out of that hose. Not exactly as much as if you cut the pool open and just let it spill everywhere, but it's a bunch of water, and there's a whole fire truck of it back there. So you can put a bunch of water on something for a pretty long time. Glycolysis produces a decent level of energy for about 3 to 5 minutes at maximal capacity. So events in track and field, for example, which really stress the glycolytic system, an 800-meter sprint. Oh, you know, last I checked, that takes about 2 minutes or so to complete, and it's a full-out effort, and the glycolytic system is super, super important to that. So anytime for maximal exertion, you do something that's 3 to 5 minutes long, that's mostly the glycolytic system. The phosphagen system kicks out after about 10 seconds. So after, from 0 to 10 seconds of running as fast as you can, mostly the phosphagen system. After 10 seconds, you're going to start to slow down, glycolysis takes hold. After 3 to 5 minutes, you can't do a half sprint anymore, you're going to have to slow down to a jog. And for jogging, our last system takes hold, and starts producing most of our energy. It's called oxidative phosphorylation. Oxidative phosphorylation occurs in the mitochondria. What oxidative phosphorylation does is it breaks down carbs, proteins, and fats all the way down into carbon dioxide and water. And in addition to that, ATP. It's a process that takes a while to get started. It has really big gears, a ton of machinery is used, the whole mitochondria is used, a bunch of chemical pathways. Oxidative phosphorylation's gears take a while to get turning, and because it's such a complex system, it doesn't produce energy really fast, but it can produce energy for a very long time. Oxidative phosphorylation of the human runs for its entire lifespan. For example, oxidative phosphorylation is what you use for jogging. How long can you jog for if you're well trained? Hours. Oxidative phosphorylation is used to power walking. How long can you walk for? You can walk for days. Oxidative phosphorylation is used for powering all of your other chemical reactions when you sit and recover. How long does it take to sit and recover? How long can you do that for? Well, I know people that have been sitting around for years, it seems like. So oxidative phosphorylation provides a slow and steady stream of energy. It can be used in sport, mostly for recovery, and for low-level endurance sport. Glycolysis is important for high, sort of moderate-level activity, basketball, soccer, that kind of stuff. For weightlifting, sprinting, jumping, phosphagen system is important, and for endurance activity, running marathons, ultra marathons, the oxidative phosphorylation system is most important. To keep up with our water analogy, oxidative phosphorylation is like opening up your tap in the faucet or in the tub. You open up the tap water and it flows for essentially as long as you want. It's not a lot at one time, but it more or less lasts forever, so long as you supply that water. So as long as you're eating food and recovering, oxidative phosphorylation can provide you energy for a really long time, which includes endurance activities as well. I think that about sums it up. Let's see if I have anything to cover. These are all details we'll go over in class. There's glycolysis, redox stuff. That's it. See you guys for the next lecture.